Okay, welcome back. We're live here in Las Vegas. This is theCUBE, SiliconANGLE's exclusive coverage of IBM's Information on Demand. I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANGLE. I'm joined by my co-host Dave Vellante, and we're talking social business, and our next guest is Renee Ducre from IBM. Welcome to theCUBE.
Thank you.
Dave, you know, I was having trouble with those names, but social business, yesterday we were teasing it up, and you know, we were riffing on that because the topic was big data analytics, mm-hmm. which shows the value side of it, the insights, all that greatness, and that's going to have the impact on business. So the conversation today is social business. So I want you to just take the folks through what's the new orientation towards social business. It's not like it hasn't been around in a while. Collaboration. Connecting with phones and email has been kind of the old way. What's the new direction of social business? Why is it important now?
All right, thank you, John. So, great question. So, once again, my name is Renee Ducre, and I'm the Director of Marketing for IBM Social Business Unit. And, you know, as we're looking at social business, and we think about, you know, the unprecedented growth and innovation that it's really been driving over the last, you know, really 5+ years, right? And some of the trends that we've been seeing with a lot of the Smarter Planet implementations that we've done. There's really some key trends that have been emerging around, you know, how people inform the decisions that they're making, as well as, you know, how they're delivering value to clients, and really leveraging, you know, one of the big payoffs of social business is really social data, right? And how they're leveraging the social data much better in, you know, really to make product and service innovation, you know, much more robust in what they're able to deliver to clients. Go ahead.
So, even a couple short years ago, you know, business people would say, what's the point of Twitter? Why do you even bother? Do you get any value out of it? And what's changed? You talk about that change and what's changed in your customer base.
Yeah, and really, you know, as we look at social business, it's so much more than, you know, the typical, when you think of social, the typical tools like Twitter and Facebook, and it's really about applying social networking tools to really, you know, improve your business, drive better, you know, more productivity across your workforce. Just as an example, you know, one of the implementations that we've done working with Boston Children's Hospital, classic example of how, you know, you take social technologies and really apply it to business, right? So working with Boston's Children's Hospital, we've created a social networking hub that allows them to share all kinds of, you know, surgical procedures. You think of how, you know, physicians were trained. There's such an explosion of data, right? There's medical journals that are creating, you know, all kinds of learnings at these exploding rates. Doctors are having a hard time keeping up with all the information, as well as all the new procedures out there. So now we've helped them create this social networking hub that houses all that information. So now physicians all over the world are able to share that information with each other. And what we're hearing are, you know, very good, when you talk about, you know, return on investment, right? We're hearing very good anecdotal stories around, you know, doctors in remote locations being able to, you know, through a mobile device, plug into that social networking hub now and actually, you know, see procedures being done real time instead of, you know, in the world of old, you had to do all of that training person to person. Very expensive, not scalable. Now they're able to share that through this networking hub at unprecedented rates, which is really helping physicians, you know, save lives, right? So we're hearing anecdotal stories about how they're able to save lives by leveraging this networking hub.
Renee, how would you characterize this, the strategy? Is it really to take the best of social networking concepts, maybe improve upon them, you know, replicate them in certain ways, and as I say, improve upon them, certainly from a, you know, maybe security standpoint and collaboration, maybe integration with other technology products, and do that in sort of a walled garden type of safe approach?
Yep.
Or is it more of a hybrid between sort of what I just described and sort of the public social networks?
And here again, I think it's, so, you know, great question. I think it's, you know, based on the needs of the client, really as well. You know, one of the things that we're seeing is definitely a need to have a secure social infrastructure, right? So working with clients to deliver that based on their needs, whether it needs to be, you know, highly secure or not. The other thing that's interesting in your question is, you know, leveraging all the social data, providing, you know, social analytics around that data to really help, you know, here again, people make better decisions, as well as, you know, to really inform the, you know, the value that they're delivering. So you think about crowdsourcing, for example, right? And a lot of the examples that we see out there with various vendors, crowdsourcing product development. So, you know, being able to improve upon their products by being able to leverage these social communities, if you will.
Okay, so it's really sort of both. And I guess it probably depends on the industry,
yep.
Some highly regulated
mm-hmm.
industries.
Exactly.
You know, it's probably one of a little bit more private.
Yep.
Others like consumer packaged goods, maybe they're trying to do some testing. And that's an industry that you came out of,
exactly.
right?
Exactly.
I mean, you cut your teeth at
exactly.
Procter & Gamble.
Exactly.
So I would imagine that there's a lot of momentum in that industry in
Definitely.
Particular. I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit and how that's changed since, I mean, when, you know, in the 90s there really wasn't any kind of public social network.
Yes.
Talk about that industry specifically and maybe we can get into some other ones.
So consumers always very, you know, very interesting, right? There's so
right.
much that you can do, especially around social, right? If you look at, you know, Procter & Gamble's always been, you know, a leader mm-hmm. in using social networks and, you know, social communities to, you know, really tap into what people like about their products, what makes a product good, why people, you know, what performance people are getting out of the products, and making sure that they also improve upon that. Every, you know, kind of turn of the crank, you'll see a new release around Tide or, you know, some new innovation. So they're very good at, you know, leveraging kind of social networks. And I think as social technologies have improved and advanced, they've been able to leverage that. The other thing that's interesting is just when I look at, you know, other consumers, right, other consumer products companies, you know, one that we point to all the time is really having done something spectacular was Oreo at the Super Bowl, right? And when you look at their real-time marketing that they did with Twitter, and even now, they're doing some very innovative things to drive engagement with clients and really kind of improve the, you know, kind of relationships with clients online. A lot of things on Twitter that I think are very clever and really getting people almost to innovate and come up with, you know, different desserts and that kind of thing and then take pictures of them, actually leveraging Twitter and Vine that are, you know, some very clever implementations that I'm seeing
cool.
as well.
So we had a comment I just posted on Twitter. What is the value of Twitter? I asked on theCUBE, and
yeah.
Some comments from the crowd captain. Traditional media is about building brands,
yep.
you know, from selling, you know, spicy nachos, you name it. You see the ad on TV, you're expected to buy it later, you're kind of offline.
Yep.
With mobile and Twitter, you can now do that online. So
mm-hmm.
the dynamics there, how do you see Twitter, for
yeah.
instance, changing the game for consumers in the spirit of brand advertising or brand marketing?
Yeah, so one thing that you know, I really see with Twitter and for business, I think it's really a very net way of getting information, right? So in our, you know, attention deficit, you know, environment that we live in, where, you know, attention is definitely a commodity, right? That everyone's trying to win. I think Twitter is a way, you know, in a very succinct number of characters. And people tend to like it for, you know, those aspects, because you can really hone in on the news channels that you're interested in, the topics that you're interested in, and get feedback real time, very succinctly, you know, with a very short blurb and a point to, you know, an article. So I see it as like, for companies, a way to, you know, very quickly send out information, send out key messages, links to demos. I also think it's a great way, like Oreo has done with the Super Bowl, you know, to really get things to go viral very quickly. And so, you know, being able to leverage now, you know, actually I was just on a panel at, it was a real-time marketing event in New York. And one of the things that is always a challenge with organizations, though, in using Twitter is the real-time aspect of it, right? And so I think for Oreo, I actually read an article for what they did at the Super Bowl, and for those that are not familiar with it, you know, they did a tweet when the lights went out at the Super Bowl this year, where they actually said, you know, you can still dunk an Oreo in the dark, right? So it was perfectly timed. And but
That's
the thing
awesome.
That went into that, like I read this article about it, and, you know, how did they pull it off? And they actually had like all of their senior executives sitting around a table that, you know, made the decision that, you know, go, we're going to, you know, post this tweet. And so you think about large organizations like IBM and, you know, other, you know, vendors, would I be able to get all of our senior leaders around a table to, you know, approve a tweet for the, you know, on the evening of the Super Bowl? That would probably be like a very career limiting thing if that was to happen, right? So
it was a flash mob, essentially. They took advantage of a trend,
exactly.
A negative trend.
And it was amazing, but, you know, you think about that in large organizations, it'd be pretty hard to pull off. So there's always that real-time nature of Twitter that's a challenge for large organizations.
So we have Big Data Alex on Twitter, Alex Phillips, so who's a great friend of theCUBE, and he says the new commodity is attention. Everyone mm-hmm. wants to win it. My comment was to that, which I agree with. The new currency is time. It's the new scarce resource. Because there's so much information. We mm-hmm. heard from Dr. Tim Buchanan earlier yesterday talking about all the alarms going off in the hospital. Yep. There's so many notifications going on. You could be bombarded with noise out there. So that's the new scarce resources time. Do you agree with that? And do you agree the attention game is what people are trying to fight for?
Definitely.
And how do businesses, you know, extract that signal from the noise, if you will? How do people break through that?
Yeah, and I think, you know, social technologies are a key way to do that because there's so many news sources, right? There's so many things that, you know, you really are trying to achieve that cut through, right, to an audience. So definitely Twitter's a way to do that. You know, in the instance that I gave you with Boston's Children's Hospital, for example, so taking those social technologies and applying it to a business, you know, from a business standpoint, I think one of the things that's great is you're able to, you know, allow people to collaborate across the world, you know, by doing a social technology hub like we did for Boston Children's Hospital, where now people in very remote locations can upload information, you know, download information to share. So I think, you know, when you think about that attention deficit, and attention is a key commodity, one thing that I think social kind of levels the playing field with on that is being able to allow people to cut through to the things that they really care about and want to hear about. So like on Twitter, you know, another example, you know, people are always wondering, how do I get more followers? How do I get more followers? If you are tweeting things that are authentic, that people are, that's relevant, it's amazing. The followers will come.
That brings up a good point I want to drill down. We also have Brenny on Twitter, who was making on CrowdChat, making a comment about Twitter's also a huge listening funnel. Mm-hmm. Jake Porway shared that Twitter data is used to identify flu breakouts. We saw that yesterday here in the keynote. So I asked you two questions on that, and that come up. You mentioned people want to try to get more followers.
Yep.
So there's really two concepts. One is the tooling available right now, still early. I want you to talk about kind of the vision and how you guys see that evolving on the tooling and the platforms for customers. What's mm-hmm. going to be automated? What in the future? Will mm-hmm. Watson make, you know, social media monitoring obsolete? Is this going to be plug and play? Mm-hmm. And two, the gamification aspect of it. People mm-hmm. are gaming Twitter mm-hmm. And social networks to get more followers or click on ads. So you can use big data to solve society problems or get more followers. So, but gamification seems it. Sort of about the tooling, kind of where we're at in your mind, and also the concept of gamification and user experience.
Okay, so all very good questions. So, you know, from a platform perspective, we have a social business platform. There are solutions around smarter workforce, which here is, you know, a lot around talent management. We have an acquisition that we did with Conexa around talent management, workforce management, a lot of robust solutions there. There's also a lot of social analytics solutions that we offer on the platform, as well as, you know, we're trying to expand that. So you'll see, you know, announcements coming from us in the future, really around including smarter workforce or smarter commerce solutions, as well as the overall umbrella, underneath the umbrella of social business. Now, from a gamification standpoint, you know, I think engagement is key, and really trying to figure out ways to increase, you know, engagement either with employees or, you know, with our customers. And gamification, I think, is a key way to do that, right? So I was actually out meeting with a client maybe a week and a half ago, Superior Group, and you're actually going to interview Tom, their CEO, later on today. And one of the things that they talked about was using a gamification element and kind of like the training of their workforce, and, you know, kind of making it fun, you know, to learn aspects of the company when people first come in, which I thought was a very clever use of gamification, right? And then there's always the, you know, all the contests that you see, you know, across all the different vendors out there, We're even looking at doing, you know, some gamification elements at some of the conferences going forward. Like anyone that's going to connect, you'll see, you know, some gamification. There's gamification over here in the corner as well. So
we have voting on crowd chats. It's a little gamification tweak. I mean, people want, I mean, this is the gesture economy, right? I mean, where people are clicking on things and making their sentiment known, either with hashtags or votes. So I got to ask you about the real-time aspect of it. You mentioned crowdsourcing earlier. Mm-hmm. This is a new phenomenon, the notion of actually measuring crowds. Mm-hmm. I mean, marketing has kind of tried to do sampling, and you know, most of the research analysts we talk to have old school mentality. Well, we sampled 250 people. Well, now you can sample 250,000 people. Mm-hmm. So you now have instrumentation, which creates interesting crowdsourcing opportunities.
Yeah, definitely.
And real time. So you got to do both. You can't. Talk about those two concepts.
Yeah, so the thing that's interesting with crowdsourcing, there's a, I was reading an article, and there was a statement in the article that said, you know, nowadays, you know, who's the smartest person in the room? You know, yesterday it used to be, you know, they used to point to a person, right? Now it's the wisdom of the crowd.
Or right? A fifth grader.
Exactly, right? So, you know, I just thought that was kind of an interesting way as they opened up the article, but it was speaking to crowdsourcing and how really, you know, when you look at like product development and, you know, a lot of the crowdsourcing models that are out there right now, you know, my boss, Scott Hebner, has small, you know, children that are like in their teens, and he talks about a crowdsourcing model where his son has already bought like an airplane, you know, that's going to be part of like a game. And, you know, the game's not coming for like another year and a half, but they've already crowdsourced millions of dollars by getting people to buy a component that'll be used as a part of the game. So, you know, I think there's a lot of very interesting crowdsourcing models out there, and I think we're just going to see more and more of it as well.
Well, the crowd has always been a very, you know, efficient, and we're in Las Vegas, handicapper, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, people always say, oh, the
That's
football
it.
Game, wow, the Las Vegas really got it right, you know,
That's
and
it.
That, it's the crowd who actually got it right, because they bet, you know, they make a market, and the crowd's determining what that line should be, essentially, right? And so, you know, they really make the market. So I have to ask you a question about the philosophy of IBM regarding social. Is it, is it my understanding that essentially you want to make social every part of an application experience? Is that ultimately where you're headed?
Exactly. So, you know, you'll start seeing more of that as different offerings come forward. You'll see more social technologies that are being brought forward. So in a lot of our solutions, we're, you know, baking in same time, for example, where there's the real-time collaboration piece that we're baking into a lot of the solutions. So definitely, as you think of being a smarter enterprise, being a social enterprise, leveraging all of the social collaboration tools is a must.
Yeah, so that talks to a complete change in the user experience.
Yep. Right? Yep.
Do you think ultimately that the social user experience is going to dominate application design? I mean, you know, 5-10 years down the road?
Yeah, you know what? I think there's no going back. Like, you know, we're at a point where, and actually our latest C-suite study that was just released maybe 2 weeks ago, it's called the Customer Activated Enterprise. And it really talks about how, you know, you have to listen to the wisdom of the crowd and your clients in order to, you know, make sure that clients are always delighted, right, with the products that you're delivering to market, and just really the importance of listening to, you know, to clients going forward. And I think it's, you know, we're seeing that in the marketplace. We're seeing that in, you know, solutions that people are bringing forward, that different vendors are bringing forward. So I think, you know, all boats arise. We're at a point where we're never going to go back, I believe. And, you know, client, you know, feedback and insights into your products is here to stay.
Well, we got a smarter crowd on crowdchat.net. And one of the questions I'll ask before we end the segment is, and we'll comment, Isabel says, crowdsourcing scales. Where are the like-minded people saying with you, connecting with that? And that came up yesterday as well as in communities you want to put, you know, smart people with the audience, whether that's customers or the community. So great comment there. But the question I want to ask you to end the segment is, does IBM plan on crowdsourcing solutions in the smarter cloud? And is the social business portfolio going to be kind of part of that smarter cloud initiative?
Ooh, that's a great question. Crowdsourcing, I think we'll always crowdsource innovation piece of it. So making sure that we listen to clients and factor, you know, all of those key learnings into the next rev of our products. I'm assuming that you're not saying from a funding standpoint.
No, just from like crowdsourcing technology, innovation. Like what we're doing here and with theCUBE is people are engaged. They want to engage, and we're seeing people do tweet chats, and as we mentioned earlier, there is an active crowd out there that is activated by other people.
Yeah, and I think, now I think crowdsourcing is like the buzzword for it, but we've been doing that for a long time, listening to clients, making sure, that we factor that into the next rev of offerings that are coming out. And I think, social technologies are enabling us to, just further evolve, how we've listened to customers over time.
I remember, just to reiterate, we said yesterday to the folks, John Awida was running comms back in 2005 timeframe when I first started. I did the first podcast with the team over there back in the day. And I remember they were doing crowdsourcing internally. IBM had huge blogging, great internal collaboration going back, it seems like a decade ago.
Yeah.
It's almost a decade ago. I mean, so you're not new, that's not new to you.
Yeah.
So final comment I want to ask you before we wrap here is, what is the new resurgence within IBM around social business? Okay, you've been doing it internally, you've been doing it with customers. That's a long time ago.
Yeah.
That was, really before Facebook and Twitter even came about.
Mm-hmm.
What's the new tweak on the model for you guys, and how do you guys look at it going forward to build on your expertise?
Okay, so I think it's, it's a couple of things. One, it's, really kind of harnessing here again, kind of the wisdom of the crowd here. And as we, go forward with our social business platform, baking in a lot of the social collaboration tools that we have into, other solutions across the corporation, it's, leveraging one of the big payoffs is around social data. So making sure that we, provide our clients with all the social analytics, to leverage all the data that they've been collecting over years that they may have been sitting on and not using to better engage with clients, to deliver exceptional client experience, be able to, innovate around the products that they're delivering. And then finally, the other piece that, no one ever thinks about is kind of the elephant in the room. But, based on, we talked about, regulatory requirements or what their needs are, but just making sure that, it's in a secure kind of social infrastructure and being able to, help our clients with that. I think those are some of the, key things that we're focused on. Making sure that as clients, deliver value, that they're able to, really, here again, leverage the social data and
analytics. Renee Ducre here live on theCUBE, Director of Marketing for Social Business here at IBM. Great conversation, great engagement online there on the Twitter comment and how you talked about these new channels, these new opportunities. It's exciting times, and certainly there's interest, and for businesses out there, it's fun to watch and
new
opportunities. So this is theCUBE, right back with our next guest after this short break.